Hey guys, welcome back to Demystified. For our third episode, we will be looking at our favorite under-construction transit project in North America, Montreal's Regional Express Network, or REM. Consider following us on social media and enjoy the video. To start off, I have to make something very clear. The REM uses full metro rail cars built by Alstom, which are very similar to those used on Sydney, Australia's new Sydney Metro project, as well as a number of other subway and metro systems worldwide. The train cars are both longer and wider than those used on the current Montreal Metro and feature a higher capacity seating layout with seats on the wall facing inward, reminiscent of many lines in London, New York, and Tokyo. Even with total train lengths in mind, a number of full metro or subway systems, such as those in Toronto, Paris, and Madrid, use similar length trains. In addition, unlike on the regular Montreal Metro, these new trains will feature AC, which should help greatly with comfort in the summer months. Now, coming off my last video, demystifying London's Crossrail, see the cards for more on that, you may be wondering, if REM is yet another project linking two disconnected railways. Fortunately, I'm happy to report REM is quite different for a number of reasons. Unlike Crossrail in London and RER in Paris, the central section of REM, as well as one of its branches extending from that section, are not new at all, and this includes the tunnel deep under Mont-Royal, Montreal's namesake, and the downtown or centre-ville of the city. This tunnel, rather than being built brand new, has existed for over a century, underutilized for mainline rail and relatively infrequent commuter service, and will be updated to modern standards both from a technical and safety standpoint as part of the project. Of course, while the REM will improve service on the existing line in the long term, the trains will be shorter. However, that doesn't preclude a return to longer trains in the future should patronage demand it, as the existing stations were already longer. Beyond enhancing existing century-old infrastructure with state-of-the-art signaling, the REM also goes a step further and connects the existing tunnel to the Montreal Metro in two new locations, at both McGill and Édouard Montpetit stations. This is no small feat, with the latter station requiring a massive new vertical connection to be constructed, with Édouard Montpetit's new lower platforms becoming the second deepest station in North America after Washington Park Station in Portland. On the periphery of the network, the REM is just as interesting. Rather than the unfortunate trend of tunnels everywhere, the REM uses a wide range of trackage styles to best suit the corridor. On the existing Dumontagne line, the REM will continue to operate on their surface with enhancements designed to improve safety and service reliability, such as full grade separation. In other locations, such as parallel to Autoroute 40 and south of downtown Montreal, the network will travel on an elevated guideway in existing corridors, enabling the project to be constructed incredibly rapidly, with visible progress across the greater Montreal region. The network will also finally connect Pierre Elliott Trudeau International Airport with the city's rail network, enabling short, reliable trips from the airport to downtown Montreal, as well as to the extent of Montreal's REM and metro networks. The new station at the airport will be under the main terminal, which is a first for Canada and utilizes existing infrastructure put there to provide for the station in the future, which is much the same as what's being done with the network's crossing of the St. Lawrence on the brand new Champlain Bridge, which was designed to carry rail in the future. Of course, all of this speaks to me, given I'm often critical of the way transit projects don't intelligently use modern construction methods, such as elevated and at-grade construction, as well as existing corridors to lower the costs of transit expansion and expedite construction. They also tend to avoid more contemporary techniques, such as phased opening, delaying what could be significant positive impacts through opening completed sections closer to completion, rather than waiting for the entire project to be done. This is plain to see, as in less than 4 years after the construction start, entire stations are visible and the network is already taking shape. In this case, the proof is in the pudding. The entire REM project was proposed in 2016 and should start opening in phases in 2021, with total completion in 2023. This is all achieved for around $6 billion Canadian, an absolutely astounding achievement when much smaller projects in North America often cost more and take more than a decade to complete. Moreover, the REM's impressive credentials are not limited to its modern and pragmatic approach to construction and infrastructure. The network will also open as the most advanced metro system in the Americas, and this will be clear to see for passengers riding the system. Beyond its automated trains, the REM will feature platform screen doors at every station, enhancing safety and comfort for passengers. A feature which, while commonplace in Europe and Asia, is a first for widespread deployment in North America. Furthermore, all trains will feature Wi-Fi, enabling seamless mobile connectivity even as passengers transfer from metro trains or at the airport deep underground. Finally, and perhaps most interestingly, stations will feature screens which not only tell patrons when their next train to their destination is coming, but how full each carriage on the train is going to be when it arrives, allowing for enhanced comfort and higher capacity than in conventional systems. Now, if you think I'm really singing the praises of the REM, you're not mistaken. At its inception, I doubted the project would ever happen. Though as a Vancouverite, I did hold out hope for a SkyTrain-style system arriving in Greater Montreal. With this, you can only imagine my shock when shovels quickly hit the ground and the project materialized right in front of my eyes at breakneck pace. To be clear, as with all projects, I can make criticisms of the REM, but I am truly impressed with how much it gets right. From the get-go, stations, operation mode, rolling stock are all well thought out. While I appreciate the anxiety felt by riders of the Deux-Montagnes line and those who have grown up using it, I truly believe people will be converted when they start riding the new completed system in only a few years. With all this in mind, to me, REM, along with Vancouver SkyTrain before it, bucked the trend of over-engineering and disorganized network planning and structures so prevalent in North America by embracing a new way of approaching regional rail. One that is built on numbers and efficiency rather than engineering for the sake of engineering. And for that, I think Montreal's REM is a great transit project. Not just for Montreal or even Canada, but for the world. And furthermore, I think it's not actually that unlike Crossrail. While the projects definitely do differ in some aspects, both fundamentally are doing the same thing, taking underutilized infrastructure and redeveloping it into a new system which goes far beyond what that original infrastructure was capable of to deliver a state-of-the-art, modern, world-class system for both of their regions. So with that, thanks for watching the third episode of Demystified. Consider supporting the channel on Patreon or following us on social media. And as always, see you again soon.